Hello, welcome everyone. Welcome in. We are so excited that you could join us today. We are very excited for this conversation entitled, What Has Cap and Trade Done for Us Lately? A crucial discussion on the benefits and drawbacks of cap and trade and the potential of cap and invest as an alternative model. So we will get started very soon. My name is Kayla Beard. I will be your host today. I am a member of Metropolitan Group, and my pronouns are she, her. I will also be your in-house tech support. So if during this webinar you have any technical difficulties, please chat me directly so that I can assist you. We'd like for this to be more of a discussion. So, as you have questions or comments, please type them into the chat box and we'll get to you as many of them as we can through the course of the conversation. If you have questions for a specific panelist, please be sure to include their name in the chat with your question. Also, Zoom has an accessibility feature that we use for our webinars. So, you should be able to see a globe icon at the bottom of your Zoom window. If you click on that and choose live transcript, you will be able to see Zoom transcribe the audio from this session in real time with moderate success. We also encourage you to share on social media if you'd like. You can use the hashtags you see here, hashtag power of voice or hashtag cap and invest. And please be sure also to tag and follow us on Twitter, AKA X, and Instagram at Met Group. Thank you so much for joining us. And we are excited to get this conversation started. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to our moderator for today's event, Vernice Miller-Travis, Executive Vice President and Environmental Justice Lead at Metropolitan Group. She will be in conversation with Jared Snyder, former Deputy Commissioner for Climate Change, Air and Energy at the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Take it away, Vernice.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning to you all on the West Coast and the Mountain States. And thank you, Jared, so very much for joining us. We were going to have a third panelist, Rory Christian. Rory is the commissioner and the chair of the New York State Public Service Commission, and Rory was called by the governor to sub for her at an event at the UN today, and he sends his profound apologies. He was practically serving up a child to say he was so sorry to have to bow out at the very last minute. But I think Jared and I will cover the landscape, and we'll make this a really interesting conversation for you. So thank you all for joining us. Let's dig in, Kayla. So I want to start with some opening and framing comments to sort of contextualize this conversation. And if you hold on just a second while I get a little more light on the subject. Oh, and you may notice that I'm sitting outside because there's stuff going on inside my house and you would not be able to hear me, so that's why I'm sitting outside. So in November of 2022, I had the great pleasure and honor to attend the United Nations 27th Conference of the Parties, COP27, high-level conference in Sharm el-Sheikh, Egypt. I went as part of the We Act for Environmental Justice and Climate Justice Pavilion delegations. The Climate Justice Pavilion was a hotbed of activity with daily programming of US and global EJ and climate justice advocates offering their perspectives on the urgency of the moment in terms of the destabilizing threat of climate change, especially for vulnerable populations the world over, and indeed here in North America. We also heard from former Vice President Al Gore and US Department of Energy Senior Director Shalonda Baker and White House Climate Policy Director Ali Zaidi, formerly of New York State government. I sat in the back of the Climate Justice Pavilion each day so I could take in the totality of the experience. It was a sight to behold. Soon, grassroots and government leaders, including former Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi and the entire US congressional delegation, were being drawn to the Climate Justice Pavilion. Even folks who didn't speak English were coming daily to the Climate Justice Pavilion. It was clear that the voices, perspectives, policy recommendations, and urgent requests of the global EJ and climate justice movements felt validated, seen, and heard via the first ever Climate Justice Pavilion. Toward the end of the first week of the COP, I moderated a panel discussion at the Climate Justice Pavilion with EPA Administrator Michael Regan, Dr. Bob Bullard, Peggy Shepherd of We Act for Environmental Justice, and Beverly Wright from the Deep South Center for Environmental Justice. And these are some of the questions that I asked. What steps is the Biden-Harris administration taking to address or mitigate the concerns of frontline communities regarding carbon capture technology and facilities coming to those very same communities? What investments must we start making now to ensure communities often left to bear the brunt of the climate crisis can heal and remain healthy? If we are successful today in refocusing how we treat frontline communities, what will the world look like? How should success be defined? Those were just some of the questions that I asked. But that question about carbon capture and sequestration almost took us off the rails. As Dr. Beverly Wright, of the Deep South's founding director of the Deep South Center for Environmental Justice, pushed back hard on EPA's embrace of CCS projects as part of the US strategy to reduce carbon emissions. But Administrator Regan did not blink or yield. And I suppose I knew this before, but at that very moment, I could see the bright lights of two trains coming at me, about to have a head-on collision over CCS. And other climate change interventions that are being widely touted, even though there is broad, deep, and loud opposition from vulnerable communities, nations, and peoples. But New York State is pursuing a different approach, and that's what we're here to discuss today with our esteemed guest speaker, Jared Snyder. Jared, thank you so very much for carving some time out. I know you're on travel. You're not at home. You're sitting in a hotel room to do this. And so just want to lift you up and say how much we appreciate you making time for this conversation.
Yeah, well, thank you very much, Bernice. I'm really glad to be here and look forward to our discussion and then any questions that come in from the audience as well.
And Jared, of course, feel free if the question is something that you don't feel you can directly answer, feel free to deflect. Answer a different question, but let's keep the conversation going. So my first question is, at present, there seems to be some fervor among regulatory agencies. And again, you have retired from New York State DEC, so that's not your active role anymore, but there seems to be some fervor to advance some form of carbon emissions markets and cap and trade, as it is more commonly known. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, so I can't really speak to the reasons for various jurisdictions, EPA or other states. I think later in this conversation we'll get into sort of New York's thinking as part of the Climate Action Council process. But I think most fundamentally, we know and what has become especially stark this past summer with all the climate disasters and the record-setting temperatures, we really need to use all the tools in the toolbox that we have to get the level of emission reductions we need to get. I think, probably in the discussions at the UN today, there's gonna be a lot of speeches about how we're not doing enough. The countries of the world are falling short of the goals they have. So we really need to ramp up efforts, and a carbon market approach is a cost-effective way of maximizing the emission reductions that you get across the economy. It also has the benefit of reaching sort of into all the corners of the economy that may not be easily addressed by other types of emission reduction strategies. And really most importantly, it puts a price on emissions of carbon, which results in internalizing that externality of the damage that greenhouse gas emissions are causing to people all across the world. So in general, placing a price on carbon can be done in one of two ways. Either the jurisdiction would set a price directly in a carbon tax, or the jurisdiction would establish a cap on emissions and allocate emissions under that cap. And that's what's commonly referred to as a cap and trade, or what Path New York is going, cap and invest approach. And if the revenues from that program, as in cap and invest, are invested in achieving emission reductions, that gives you a double reduction benefit. First, the carbon price results in decisions by private actors, whether it's businesses, individuals, that reduce their own emissions. And then second, those investments can be used to provide further emission reductions across the economy. And so I think that's probably why there is, you know, some interest in you know, this you know, possible regulatory mechanism for helping to achieve the level of emission reductions we need.
Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna jump around in our questions a little bit, but I'm gonna want to really dig in on the cap and invest model with you. But the first question I want to start with, Jared, is, or the second question, given that really great framing you did of what that marketplace looks like, I am of the opinion, and many others, you know, who lean towards the environmental justice, climate justice sort of perspective, wonder if you can, at a fundamental level, incorporate equity and justice considerations and anti-discrimination. Can you integrate those into a market-based approach or mechanism? Is that what a market-based mechanism allows us to do?
Yes, you can incorporate those goals in the development of a market-based mechanism. And you know, New York is doing that in the development, the ongoing development of a cap and invest approach, as envisioned by the scoping plan that was finalized at the end of 2022. There's really, you know, a couple of ways of doing that. First, and I think we sort of jumped ahead. Let me back up a little bit on what cap and invest is.
Excellent. So cap and invest, that was going to be my next question.
Okay. Cap and invest places a cap across the economy, a cap on emissions, and that cap goes down over time to meet the emission reduction goals. So in New York, that would end up declining to meet the very aggressive emission reduction targets in the state's climate act. And then under cap and invest, the auction, an auction is held to allocate emission allowances to the regulated entities. And that auction provides significant proceeds for the state to use in addressing and obtaining additional emission reductions. One way of addressing the equity impacts is to target those investments to disadvantaged communities. So in New York, the climate law requires that at least 35% of the proceeds of any you know, programs that New York puts into place, at least 35% of the proceeds must benefit disadvantaged communities, with a goal of at least 40% of the proceeds being used for that purpose. The scoping plan that New York adopted at the end of 2022 also provides for active engagement of disadvantaged communities in the selection and implementation of those strategies that would reduce emissions in their community. So that's one mechanism, the investment side. But then also on the program design side, New York is considering, and this is specified in the scoping plan, New York is considering a number of potential innovative mechanisms to address local impacts. Those include things like not allowing or limiting trading between sources in disadvantaged communities and sources outside disadvantaged communities. So that a power plant, say, located in a disadvantaged community cannot increase its emissions by buying emission allowances from outside that community. So that's one mechanism. Another mechanism is potentially placing hard caps that would go down over time on the sources in disadvantaged communities. They're still going to have to buy allowances to cover their emissions. They're still going to bear a carbon price, but they will not be able to increase their emissions. In fact, over time, their emissions would have to decline. So that's another mechanism that New York is looking at. Let me address a couple other things. I'm getting a weird, I have to just close out something on my screen. There we go. And then we're also doing air quality monitoring in New York that would identify where elevated levels of emissions are in disadvantaged communities and enable the additional monitoring to ensure that emission reductions go down over time as a result of the investments. And then you can also address affordability impacts on low-income consumers. And that's another innovation that is going to be undertaken in New York. Under the budget that was passed this year, Governor Hochul signed the budget that gives the agencies authority to implement a rebate mechanism that would mitigate any increased price impacts borne by lower income communities. So, you know, all these ways are ways of addressing it. Let me just emphasize one additional thing. And then at the same time, you know, states like agencies like DEC don't just address the carbon emissions. They have programs that directly address the other emissions from these sources. Those are tightened over time to meet air quality standards. Mm-hmm. And, you know, those are other tools to ensure that we're reducing emissions in disadvantaged communities as a cap and invest program goes forward.
So, Jared, let me take a step back, a little bit of a step back. I was immediately drawn to the path that you all were following because I thought you were doing some innovative things in New York State. But one of them was to really take a long, hard look at that cap and trade model and the need to think about and create something that would operate differently. What was the motivating factor that made you and your colleagues say, you know, we need to pursue a different path and landed on that cap and invest model?
Okay. Well, you know, a fundamental difference between cap and invest and cap and trade is how the allowances are distributed, right? And in a cap and trade model, a conventional cap and trade model, I should say, the allowances are allocated for free to the regulated entities. And you know, they get a limited number of allowances. If they want to emit more than that amount, they need to trade with others, you know, buy allowances from another source that would then have to reduce its emissions. That's the conventional cap and trade model. Cap and invest is different because instead of giving those allowances away for free, those allowances are auctioned in an auction that the regulated entities can participate in. And that provides revenues. And those revenues can then be invested in reducing emissions across the economy in ways, in areas that are addressed by the cap and invest program or other portions, say, you know, in agriculture, for example. And so it provides that additional benefit. I mean, ultimately, with the cap and trade program, the allowances have value. And what fundamentally a cap and invest program envisions is that value should go to the public. And that value can go to the public in the form of investments that members of the public can take advantage of, like, you know, energy efficiency, renewable energy in their homes, or it can go to the public in the form of rebates, which we, you know, which I just talked about. So that really is sort of the fundamental difference between cap and invest. Cap and invest is a much more powerful mechanism for reducing emissions because it's not just the price, it is also the investments that are contributing to the emission reductions. So that's the distinction. It is really the Climate Action Council itself that made the decision to pursue the cap and invest model. And, you know, do you want me to go into that?
Yes, please.
A bit? Okay, so, you know, in developing the scoping plan, you know, a couple of things, a couple of issues became apparent in the course of the development of the plan. One is, you know, we have extremely aggressive emission reduction goals in New York, and all the multiple strategies that were being identified, you know, despite covering many, you know, many different parts of the economy, may not be sufficient to achieve the level of emission reductions required. We couldn't guarantee that those programs and policies, like supporting electric vehicles and, you know, switching buildings to heat pumps, things like that, building the renewable energy future, we couldn't be sure that those could be done in, you know, expeditiously enough to meet the emission reduction goals. So there was the identification of a need for an economy-wide program that would support additional emission reductions and ensure that the emission reduction goals were met. A second issue that was identified is a lot of strategies required funding, a lot of other strategies in the scoping plan, and funding sources had not been identified. So the auction of allowances under the Cap and Invest program provides the funding to implement all those other programs and policies in the scoping plan. So at the council's direction, you know, we identified, staff at DEC and ISERTA identified two primary options to address those issues. You know, one would be implementing a carbon tax. Another would be the Cap and Invest program. Both would provide revenue for investment. Both would stimulate additional emission reductions. But only the Cap and Invest approach could be designed to ensure that the statewide emission reduction limits were met, because the cap could align with that statewide emission reduction limit. So we presented those options to the council, and the council, you know, really for that reason, I think identified the Cap and Invest as the preferred model. So that's what's reflected in the scoping plan and what the agencies are currently developing in the regulatory process.
And Jared, let me ask you, at the same time that you're building this architecture, there's this innovative public engagement process going on at the same time. Can you describe that process, the variety of people who sat at the table?
Yeah, certainly. Yeah, there's a number of different ways, and this is the Climate Action Council process.
Yes.
That I'm going to talk about first. You know, there's a number of different ways where it implemented or considered and the input of various stakeholder groups. And these are really specified in the governing legislation itself. First, the Climate Action Council itself includes representatives of a number of interest groups, really all across the economy. There's representatives of the power industry, there's a representative of clean energy, a representative of environmental organization, an EJ advocate, and you know, those and you know, among others. And so their voices were heard in the Climate Action Council process over the really 3 years that was underway. So that's one. Second, and this is really going to those equity considerations specifically, the law required the council to consult periodically with an organization set up by the climate law called the Climate Justice Working Group, which included 9 representatives of environmental justice organizations across the state of New York. Mm-hmm. And those conversations, some of which were difficult, as you might imagine, led to some of the refinements to the Cap and Invest model, which you see reflected in the scoping plan, some of those program design elements that I talked about. And then the third way of getting stakeholder input in this process is public hearings were held across the state. I think there was 9 or 10 public hearings. And then the public also was able to submit written comments. I think we had over 35,000 comments came in.
Wow.
Now those come into to all aspects of the draft plan, but that included a number of comments relating to how a economy-wide program should be designed. So that's the Climate Action Council process. Now the regulatory process is taking place. I'm not involved in that anymore because that started in 2023 after I retired from the agency. But the agencies, DEC and NYSERDA, are now engaged in it, the regulatory development process, and that includes a number of public meetings and listening sessions to gather input on the design of an economy-wide program to design of the cap and invest program specifically. And there's a website that people can access, it's capandinvest.my.gov that people can access if they want to get more input on those various learning sessions and listening sessions that are have been held or are going to be taking place in the future.
So, Jared, let me ask you this, because as you all were building this architecture, as you were having the council, as you were having the EJ working group work through so many dimensions of what this would look like, the federal government, particularly the White House Council on Environmental Quality, was building some architecture of its own to help define what a disadvantaged community looked like for the purposes of rolling out some of their policy, the Justice 40 initiative. How would they mete out many of the climate programs that they were rolling out and building at the time? And a point of departure, I remember I literally almost had a stroke because I read an article in the New York Times. Just happened to, I was reading the paper this morning and up popped this article that says the federal government and the administration in particular, as it was defining disadvantaged communities for the purpose of implementing dozens and dozens and dozens of federal programs, was not going to use race as a metric. And I really thought I was going to have a stroke. And I'm like, you've got to be kidding me, right? But also understanding the political moment that we were in, the case that was going to the Supreme Court that we've now since seen a decision in, recognizing that they felt that there were some constraints and they didn't want to step into that space. So they took race off the table and thought that, we can use a lot of other metrics that can still get us to the same outcomes. And I felt strongly that that was not the case. And it seemed like in a matter of days, New York State rolled out its definition for disadvantaged community. And there were two things in it that jumped out at me. One, you all included, or they included, race as a metric, but they also included, I think it's either up to 200% or 400% of the federal poverty level as a metric in defining what a disadvantaged community is for the purposes of New York State. And I thought both of those things were game changers. I thought it allowed the state of New York to really lean in and step forward and separate itself from the morass that was growing around that definition. But you all didn't seem to blink, or your former colleagues didn't seem to blink about how important this was and that you were prepared to defend that decision in any fora. How did that happen, Jared? And what made New York go so completely differently than where the federal government landed?
Yeah, so the disadvantaged criteria were established by the Climate Justice Working Group. And that was a very extensive process of looking at literally, I think, 6 or 7 dozen criteria that could be part of the designation of disadvantaged communities. And, a number of the representatives on that group, based on their experience in those communities, felt it was very important that race be one of the many factors that are considered. It's not an overriding factor, by any means. It's just one of dozens of criteria that are considered. Mm-hmm. I don't want to speak for, you know, the attorneys in New York State government that have evaluated this and probably, you know, evaluated it anew after the Supreme Court decision. But I think that consideration of race among many, many, many factors is really what distinguishes this from the affirmative action cases that were at issue in the two Supreme Court decisions where I think race played, you know, perhaps a more significant role in design of those programs.
Well, it was a high water mark in what was a very disillusioning moment as we move this conversation forward. I had the opportunity to be in conversation with Governor Hochul in the same week. It just was a lot of serendipity was happening that week around this conversation. And I asked her this question, you know, why did New York go so dramatically differently than where the federal government landed? And she said, without missing a beat, well, these communities have suffered for a really long time, and it's time that we did something to protect them. Don't you think? And then we moved on to the next question. Yeah. And I was like, well, that was pretty concise. And, you know, there it is. And she also said, and we are prepared to defend that decision in any fora that we are asked to defend it. And that just made me feel so good about, you know, New York is my home state, though I've lived in Maryland for the past 25 years. I just thought it was courageous, but it also was the right thing to do. And I'm hoping that there are other states that in this very difficult moment around how to navigate the spaces around the inclusion or exclusion of race as a marker, as a metric, as part of a program, that they look to what New York State has done to say that, you know, you can move forward. And I agree with you, Jared. It is one of many, many, many metrics. It's not the only metric, but if you leave it out, it becomes very problematic. And we're starting to see some research that says when you don't include race as a metric, it doesn't get you to the kind of outcomes that you're ultimately trying to get to in terms of providing equal protection and providing benefits to all kinds of populations if you take race out as a metric.
Right. And I'd say in the New York process, where this was determined by the Climate Justice Working Group and not the state, that's where that perspective really comes into play. The experiences of the people in these communities themselves, you know, was really critical in defining those criteria and those disadvantaged communities.
Well, I after that, you know, I became a huge fan of yours and your colleagues for doing what I thought was courageous, also the right thing. Obviously, the data led you there, right? You wouldn't do it just off the top of your head. It was a very reasoned decision that the agency landed at with your partners.
Yeah, and I have to say, I can't take any credit for that. That was, you know, there was the environmental justice team in New York that was really overseeing that process and working with the Climate Justice Working Group.
Well, bravo to everyone in New York who did that. And I hope it will serve as a model for many of us who are grappling with this around the country, trying to figure out where to land, what to do, how to structure and build programs, et cetera. Kayla, do you think we should take some questions? Because I see we have some great questions in the chat.
Yes, I was just going to remind you all, yes, there are some questions. Would you like me to read them?
Yes, please.
All right. The first one we have comes from Elizabeth Select-LaRue. Are there any restrictions on investments that might further entrench fossil fuel dependency?
I would say, you know, on that the program itself is still being designed. You know, I envision, you know, that I can't envision New York, you know, using the proceeds to support any expansion of fossil fuel networks, fossil fuel infrastructure at all. That would really be inconsistent with the program. The investments would need to support continued emission reductions. So I think that's extremely unlikely. I don't know whether the ongoing process would sort of make that explicit, or really it's more implicit in that the reductions, the investments need to support emission reductions and should not support fossil fuel infrastructure.
Thank you. Next question.
Thank you. This question is from Jeff Jones. He says, what is the relationship between New York's Cap and Invest planning and the existing RGGI coalition?
That's the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative Coalition, REGI, as it's commonly referred to.
Yep. Well, one of the questions that DEC and NYSERDA, the Energy Research and Development Authority, are considering in the design process for the Cap and Invest program is how REGI and the Cap and Invest program should interact. There's a number of possibilities that could be considered. Those are among the issues being considered. I believe there was a listening session or a learning session that took place a few weeks ago on sort of how to cover the power sector, which is already covered by the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, how that should be covered by the Cap and Invest program. So there's a lot of thinking going into that. Because I'm no longer at DEC, I'm not sure specifically, what the current leanings are, but I'm sure we'll hear more from the agencies in the future on that subject.
Next question, Kayla.
Next, this question comes from Tim Miller. In most states, are emitters allowed to count renewable energy credits, RECs, for electric, and renewable thermal certificates, RTCs, for natural gas, to help comply with their emissions reductions? And if so, are those credits usually required to come from in-state projects?
So I really think that is a different type of program. New York does have a clean energy standard that considers those types of issues. I don't think renewable energy credits or renewable thermal credits would really play any role in the design of a Cap and Invest program. They don't in REGI right now, which is, a Cap and Invest program. And I'm not sure of them playing a role in any other economy-wide cap and trade or Cap and Invest programs.
So I'm gonna jump back in with some other questions. I just have a couple more. And one of them, Jared, is we saw a recent ruling in a case in West Virginia about the Clean Power Plan and the EPA's ability to regulate in this space and state regulators. And so now, given that ruling, do state regulators still have the ability to enforce market-based mechanisms like cap and trade or cap and invest, or is there a curtailment of the ability of states to think creatively about what to do in that space?
Yeah, I don't think it affects state authority whatsoever.
Okay.
That decision is really a fairly narrow decision affecting EPA's authority under one particular provision of the Clean Air Act.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't affect state authority whatsoever. Under the Clean Power Plan, which was at issue in that case, EPA provided a pathway for states to possibly use cap and invest programs or other types of programs to meet the goals of the regulatory program of the Clean Power Plan. That's what was vacated by the Supreme Court.
Okay.
EPA is now, you know, proposing or is developing a replacement rule. And, you know, it remains to be seen whether there will be a potential role for cap and invest programs under that. Mm-hmm. But it certainly doesn't affect the authority of each state under its own law to adopt its own cap and invest program.
Well, that's good to hear. I think we're all anxiously awaiting the replacement rule to see what it looks like with the constraints that the Supreme Court has rolled out. And then another question I have for you, Jared, is that you and I were in a meeting with the Great Plains Institute and the Conveners Network and the State Deployment Initiative, multiple states in the room with us in Chicago in, that was either June or July. And I felt in the conversations that went on that there was just a tremendous amount of energy around carbon capture. And back to that question again, back to that issue again. And it was almost taken as a given that this is going to be something that we deploy in our arsenal to reduce carbon emissions. But I know that there is a tremendous amount of energy in opposition to that, particularly from communities that are overburdened by the sources of carbon emissions. What can we do? Where is the space, Jared, to bring folks together to have reasoned conversations to figure out what we're going to do in this space?
Well, I would say, you know, under New York, you know, in our scoping plan, there is very, very little role for carbon capture and sequestration. You know, that I think is primarily thought about as a potential interim mechanism for those very hard to decarbonize industries. You know, think about things like cement plants that require a very high temperatures, and those temperatures right now are provided by combustion of fossil fuels. As we move forward, you know, maybe new technologies will be developed to replace that. But in the interim, you know, carbon capture and potential reuse instead of sequestration of the carbon, like injecting it back into the cement that's being produced, you know, can be part of the design in the interim. What we really need to be mindful of is making sure that, you know, carbon capture and sequestration isn't sort of a Trojan horse, you know, for allowing continued dependency on fossil fuels from sources that can be addressed through other mechanisms like power plants that can switch, you know, we can switch power generation to renewable energy. And so it has, you know, we just need to make sure that it is not, you know, used to allow the continued reliance on fossil fuels. And where it is being used in some of those more limited cases where we use carbon capture and sequestration, and you know, that it be accompanied by other strategies to reduce the other pollutants. Carbon capture and sequestration only addresses the carbon, right?
Right.
So you want other strategies, other emission controls to ensure that those other pollutants are being addressed. So again, think about it as temporary, and really focused primarily on those really hard to decarbonize sources, and then other programs to mitigate any effect from other pollutants.
I so appreciate you saying what you just said, because the folks who are particularly near oil and gas generating facilities, are really worried about the embrace of CCS. And are we really focusing enough attention on really reducing our dependency on fossil fuels, and really looking to invest in more regenerative and sustainable sources of energy? And does carbon capture, and I see a question here from Elizabeth, that she's heard in a public forum, someone in the oil and gas industry saying that cap and invest technology will allow the fossil fuel sector to continue to roll on, right? As opposed to really investing in what do we do to invest equitably in alternative energy so we can reduce carbon emissions. This is a really big question. And I know that, you know, there are people on all sides of this, but I wanna see a process where the folks who are living on the fence line, as it were, are central to the debate around what the next steps are, what we do, how we invest public dollars, and that we do it in a way that really focuses on the needs of those communities. What do you think about that?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, the continued stakeholder engagement and hearing the voices of those communities is going to be really important. That's how you get sort of, you know, resilient decisions that stand the test of time, is where you're hearing from all the interests in developing the policies going forward, and not sort of excluding any of those important voices.
So, Jared, we're coming down to the end of our conversation, and I want to know, one, if you have any questions, but two, just to give you the opportunity to say, if you could build and construct and model a scenario that you think could really position us as a nation, as a global community, as folks are, you know, having Climate Day at the UN today, the Climate Summit at the UN today. If you could build and construct the best model, what would that look like to take us in a different direction and to really bring us back off the brink of climate catastrophe where we are right now?
I mean, I would say that the answer to that is sort of easy. The best model, and I don't mean to be a cheerleader for you know, my old agencies in New York, but you know, the scoping plan that was developed in New York provides a really good model. The way that it incorporates, you know, environmental justice considerations across the board, the way it addresses all sectors of the economy, the way it combines, you know, economy-wide programs like Cap and Invest with specific targeted programs that reduce emissions from various sectors, the way it prioritizes investments in disadvantaged communities, you know, investments like, you know, reducing, diesel truck traffic in disadvantaged communities that are, you know, really, you know, exposed to higher levels of that diesel truck traffic than other communities at this point in time. So I think that the scoping plan in New York provides a really good model for you know, other you know, jurisdictions, whether it's other states to look at or other nations, in developing their own approaches to addressing climate change.
Love that. So we have two more questions from our audience, and Lauren, I'm going to skip down to the bottom of your question, to that last piece of your question. I think that's the heart of it. But a question before that is, where is that question? It was about offshore wind. Does Cap and Invest, I've lost the question, but I'm trying to reconstruct it from memory. Does Cap and Invest planning allow for the investment of more offshore wind and more alternative sources of energy?
The building out the renewable energy power system in electricity system in New York is being supported by a suite of programs. The Climate Act requires, you know, New York's electricity system to be to be, you know, fully renewable by 2040. And so, you know, the investment in renewable energy technologies, you know, like offshore wind and others, is really integral to that process. And I should say, actually, by 2040, it needs to be emission free. electricity system. So you know, offshore wind plays a critical role in New York, particularly given all the electricity that is used downstate. It provides a mechanism to get renewable energy, clean renewable energy, into that downstate grid, New York City and Long Island. And so the state has invested a lot of effort into building that sector, and that's going to continue. And Cap and Invest could provide additional support for it.
And our last question is going to be this really tremendous question from Lauren Johnson in the chat. And Lauren, as I said, I'm going to jump down to the bottom. Her concern, and she's reflecting the concern that many, many, many have had, that Cap and Invest sort of distributes and market-based mechanisms distribute the reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, but not necessarily strives to reduce and eliminate emissions, but rather to bring them down, but not to eliminate them altogether, right? So Lauren's fundamental question is, how can we guarantee Cap and Invest supports, that Cap and Invest supports local disproportionate pollution reductions? And are regulations more effective for reducing pollution impacts and greenhouse gas emissions? And if so, should they be pushed more than Cap and Invest? Should there be a regulatory scheme that is the corner of that process as opposed to a market-based mechanism?
Yeah, I think really it can be both, right? You know, as I said, we have, you know, a number of programs that are intended to address those other pollutants from sources in disadvantaged communities and elsewhere. And, you know, over time, those are being strengthened. What you know, Cap and Invest provides is really two things. You know, the proceeds for investment in clean technologies. You know, again, think about you know, getting those diesel trucks off the road. The investments can support the replacement of those trucks with trucks powered by electricity. That's just like, you know, a single example. Second is, you know, the question referred to getting to the you know, eliminating all emissions. And, you know, in New York, where we have a goal of net zero emissions by 2050, you know, the Cap and Invest approach could be designed to get us to that point, so that by 2050, we are at zero net emissions across the economy.
So I just want to say 2050 is a long time from now. And those elongated time frames that we're thinking about, a lot of harm can continue to be done. There can continue to be a lot of loss of life. Is there a way to, you know, really truncate that time frame so that we really get to not just cost savings, but life savings?
Yeah. Well, I mean, and that's just the end. That's just the 2050 goal. There's also a 2030 goal of 40% emission, or not goal, but actual target that has to be met of 40% emission reductions by 2030, which is obviously a lot closer. So, you know, agree completely that as fast as that transition can be made, it's important. It does take time, though, to build out the, you know, the alternative sources of energy, to build the wind farms, for example, to build the solar farms, to convert all vehicles to electricity, you know, all trucks to electricity, to replace the natural gas infrastructure in homes with heat pumps and other emission-free ways of providing heat for heating, cooling, cooking, etc. So that takes time. Granted, as quickly as it can take place, better. But you know, we just you know, need to be somewhat practical with you know, those considerations.
Well, Jared, I want to thank you for being so open, so transparent, and for allowing me to be one of your biggest fans, for stepping out there, and you and your colleagues, your former colleagues, having done some great work, but also to lift up the environmental justice working group and the climate justice advocates that were part of this process, I know they put in countless hours to get us to this place. And I am hoping that other states will look at what you have done in New York State collectively and collaboratively and recognize that you cannot get to solution if you don't have the folks who are most affected by the challenges in that process, at that decision-making table, creating and crafting those processes, those strategies, and being courageous in so doing. And I just want to thank you, Jared, for opening up and being with us. And I just want to say that if Rory had been here, we wouldn't have gotten through all these questions, because that would have been a whole different discussion with Rory, Jared, and I. So Kayla, thank you, Jared, so very much. Kayla, back to you.
Yeah, and thank you, Vernice, for including me. And actually, thanks also for that shout out to all the effort that the Climate Justice Working Group members put into this process in New York. And I should also give a shout out to all the, you know, dozens, probably even hundreds of agency staff that put indeed. In a lot of time to make this a successful effort.
Indeed, indeed. Jared, somebody put in the chat, we miss you at DEC.
Yeah, I saw that.
Kayla, close
the
session.
Thank you so much, Jared and Vernice. Thank you for a wonderful conversation. Thank you all for being here. You can reach out to Vernice at vernice@metgroup.com and keep this conversation going on social media. Tag us at metgroup. And thank you for your questions. Thank you. And have a great rest of your day.
Bye, everybody. Thank you.